Joyful Souls, this is Quinn Curtis, and you are listening to Joyful Living. Welcome. Today, we're going to be talking about how to do the balance. So this balance I'll specifically be pointing to today is how to do the balance between growing a business and showing up as an awesome parent and growing a family. But if you happen to be not raising a family at this time, but maybe feel like you're juggling a lot of things, so maybe you're working a full-time job and trying to grow your business on the side, you're really wanting that business to take over, the strategies and insights that I'll be sharing in today's episode will absolutely be 100% applicable in that situation as well. So I will be speaking to parents, but know that you can totally translate and that there's a massive bit of value here for you as well, regardless. So just as a premise, it always is so fun wherever I travel all over the world, when people hear that I have 5 children, their jaws just drop. Like, people cannot believe that 5 babies walked out of this body. And then when I tell them that they're all ages 12 and under, and that I had 6 pregnancies in 8 years, their minds are just blown. They cannot even handle it. One of those is a miscarriage, if you're like, how does this math add up? And so honestly, I've been doing my business for the past decade. And so all of that time, I've had children that I've been raising alongside growing a business. I've never had the luxury of not raising my business while also raising my family. Now, I say luxury just because some days I do fantasize about how nice it would be to have, just my own time to devote to everything all the time. But darn it, I would miss those little cutie pies, and I'm so glad they're here. So it's been a great journey. The other thing that I think is really important to understand is that for any of you listening, I know that when I've heard similar kinds of conversations from parents who are talking all about how to do it, you look behind the scenes and you see, wow, they have a major support team. Like, their spouse is bringing in really great money, which allows them to take some risks in their business and be a good mom. And it doesn't hurt them financially. Like, they can still afford to pay their groceries and their mortgages or their rent. In my situation, that has definitely not always been the case. I have an amazing husband who I love like crazy, and who has a very different gift and skill set than I do. And it took us a long time to really realize that. And so my business was born out of not having enough money, even with him working 2 to 3 jobs at a time and our family just really not making it. And so I never had the luxury of him just taking off work so that I could work on my business. It was always squeezing in my business and all the little spare cracks of our life, which was often, you know, often worked and then often was a little bit stressful and created some other experiences that I got to learn from. So it's been quite a journey. The point that I'm at now with my family is I have been able to bring my husband home full time for this past year. But mind you, I had already created at least a 6-figure income prior to that happening. And so, you know, the big foundation of getting the business laid and having, having sustainable income that we could count on coming in every single month, I mean, that took years. And then now, because we've been intentional and through some of the strategies that I'm going to share with you today, now he is able to be home and we're creating more and more of the life that we want as a family, which involves having a full-time dad at home and around and him being able to go back to school as he desires and study the things that he's passionate about. So that not just I can be doing work that I love and am passionate about and also get to spend more time with our family, but he also gets to benefit from that as well. So if you are even a single mom listening to this, know that for most of my business creation period, I have been building this alongside being full-time parent. So we're all full-time parents if you're a parent listening, right? But that term, I think, really applies to there is nobody else that can watch the kids for you or can, you know, do things and support you that can't do bedtime, that you're pretty much doing everything from when they wake up, feeding them, keeping them alive, keeping them clothed, keeping the house from getting condemned from a disaster mess, all the way until tucking those little monster cherub beauties into bed at night. So growing a business right alongside of that. That's what I'm talking about. So any of these strategies, know that that's the melting pot where all of this was born. So I have six strategies that have really made a major difference in being able to do this balance, if you will, of growing a business and being a really present, involved, connected mother and wife, we could say too, but I'll focus on a mom as well. So the first one is laser clarity about what is helpful and what is not. Now this one has been a little bit painful to learn. Maybe they've all been painful, but laser clarity has been where, if you've heard of that crazy disease called FOMO, or fear of missing out, has really struck me. I love to be involved. If I could, I would be out at every single event, at every single retreat. I just love events and I love being around people. I do have quite a lot of social anxiety, but I love just the atmosphere of learning and events. And I just, for many years, felt really discouraged that all my friends or everybody on Facebook was posting that they just went to this super cool event and they did this really cool thing, or now they're all doing this certain program or whatever it might have been. And I had to always keep bringing it back to, is this helpful to my family or not? Does this really affect our bottom line? Does it really make me a better parent or a better person to enough of a degree that is worth the cost to my family, right? Because every single business decision that has been made over the years has had to have been made saying, knowing that if I say yes to this thing in business, I might have to say no to something with my family. And so it's gotten me just laser focused about what really is helpful to growing my business and increasing our income and what is not, and letting the what is not go, which has required me to let go of FOMO to a big degree, and to also be a lot more comfortable with dancing to the beat of my own drum in growing my business, which has not always been easy. I think it's very natural, especially as you hop on Facebook or Instagram and everybody's offering, you know, the program that's going to change your life, or the six strategies that are going to make it so you're a millionaire in a weekend. And it can be really tricky to stay focused on our path and really trust that it is the right way to go, even though we're not having this massive inflow financially, maybe in that moment. And so this has also been a real path of getting very close to my heart and soul and to the divine, and really leaning into trusting my path and staying in my own lane, right? So that's been a huge strategy right there. The second major strategy is to be able to practice presence. And this one has really been inspired and born from reading Eckhart Tolle's work of The Power of Now and A New Earth. Those were the two most powerful books that I read years ago in the beginning of my entrepreneurial journey, or at least in the first couple of years, that made such a major difference in helping me to see that my presence is the greatest gift that I can bring to any situation. So before that, I had felt really stressed about, okay, when I'm a mom, I need to show up as a perfect mom. And what do perfect moms do? And I would think through and I would think, okay, maybe perfect moms would bake cookies. That was a big rumor in my family. My mom had this darling belief that good moms always have the cookie jar filled. So in my, you know, growing up with my kids being little years, that was a stressor where I was always feeling like I didn't add up. I wasn't enough because I wasn't keeping that cookie jar filled. Dang it. So recognizing that actually what your kids want more than cookies, and you know this, we know this, but how often do we practice this and really trust it, that all our kids really want is for us to be present with them. Right? They want to feel seen and heard and loved. And the way that we do that best is through practicing presence. And so that involved in the beginning, just being able to sit with my children and turn off my thoughts and just be with them however they were being. And in the beginning, I had so many anxieties about myself and how I was being a parent or our life or finances or whatever else, that I found that most of the time I wasn't being present. I was so lost in my thoughts that I was 1000% distracted from the real life that was happening all around me. And as soon as I started to just try to turn off those thoughts, which is like a muscle that you've got to strengthen. And I think even some of our earlier episodes really addressed presence, if you want to go back and listen, or certainly reading any of Eckhart Tolle's work. But turning off the thoughts, just being with my family, turned off that nagging negative voice that was like, you're not enough, you should be a better mom, you're doing all the wrong things, blah, 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 and was really discouraging and sabotaging my ability to show up each day and really love my kids and be what they needed, be there for them. And so presence has been powerful, that I know anytime I want to bring the greatest amount of love and peace and patience and joy to any situation, I've got to activate presence. And presence is a funny bug. We won't go into it too in depth right now, but I'll just give you two little tips with practicing presence. One of the fastest ways to get into presence is through gratitude. So that's when you're having just a really rough day, the kids are like climbing all over the walls and things are insane, your to-do list, you're drowning in it, right? It's a perfect moment to turn on more presence and to just stop for a minute and just start naming off what you're grateful for in your brain and taking a nice big deep breath. Also, nature brings us to presence really, really effectively and powerfully. And so I would find myself, even if I couldn't just look at my kids and be with them in that moment, I could look out the window and just really allow myself to be with the tree or watch the clouds for a minute. And it would bring me back into my body and back into presence, which made a major difference. And then as this evolved, it allowed me to then see my children and just get lost in them, just like I was getting lost in the clouds, and just be able to really see and love and value them. So this is something that I don't know that we ever get perfect at with presence, but it is a practice that is absolutely essential if you're wanting to really do the balance, because how this has evolved to now is that I know when I'm in my business and I'm in my set business hours, the greatest gift that I can bring to my business is presence also. So the same strategies I was practicing with my kids, I've brought into my business, and that allows me to really bring my best in my business and then to shift gears to my family pretty harmoniously. It's not always perfect. Sometimes it's a little messier than normal, but that has been a strong home base to keep coming back to. Okay. So the next piece really goes along with that one, the third strategy, which is to find and really lean into your genius and joy zone. And what this does is this allows us to show up as the very best self of us in both worlds. So similar to presence. And honestly, the shortcut here is that presence brings you into your genius zone also. So if you, can't keep track of all of the tips, or you're like, where do I start? I would start with presence, because presence will help you find laser clarity, like we were talking about in strategy number one. It will help you to find your genius zone, and it will open up more joy in your everyday life in both areas of your home and family. So genius zone for me has looked like really letting go of all of the shoulds about what I thought I should be doing in my business and what I thought you should do to be a good mom, and instead recognizing, well, where's my genius zone? And in my business, this looks like a genius zone of being able to really see people in their absolute brilliance and their humanity, being able to see it all and see the truth of who they really are in a way that helps draw that truth out more. And so then, how does that genius zone help and show up in my family? Well, first of all, by staying in that genius zone and doing more and more of the work that lights me up and energizes me in my business life, it just brings back all of this energy and joy and passion into my family life. They get a really energized mom whenever I'm, showing up in that role. And the other part is that it helps me to stay really clear and focused on where can I make the greatest contribution in my children's lives. So presence is definitely the first place, just being there. But the second place is it helps me be aware of really crucial conversations with my kids, or of how I treat them or how I respond to them, because I want to draw out their brilliance as well. If I have drawn out the brilliance in all of my clients, but I fail to see and honor that in my own children and my own spouse, I've failed. It would not have been worth it, right? So the clarity in really dialing in and getting more on fire in my genius and in my business absolutely has magnified my ability to be a better mom and to stay in my genius zones there and show up in the really important ways. So yes, we bake cookies sometimes, but baking is not my genius zone. So if one of the kids is coming to me and they're really having a hard time, and then, you know, we look at some of the emotional layers that they're working with and some of the stressors and the beliefs that are coming up. And it's a very similar process to what I do in my business, but it's much more just, you know, it's just a natural way of being. Our genius zones are natural to us. So it just helps me to let go of all the areas where I think I should be doing more in parenting. I mean, there's always places we can do more, right? But it helps me to let go of that stressor and instead just show up as, like, you know, I'm here to serve. How can I serve in my business, and how can I serve in my family with this genius zone that's been given to me? All right. So that would be strategy number three. Strategy number four is all about soulful strategic branding, which you knew I had to bring up, but it really has made such a difference because my brand does the heavy lifting of communicating the value that I have in business out to the world, while I am able to do other things. So I don't spend a ton of my time convincing people that they need to work with me or really looking for people to work with. I have really stayed so rooted in my genius zones and in really showing up to serve fully there in my business that my business has largely run on referrals, which has kept me very busy. But even without the referrals, my brand out on the, you know, social media platforms or on my website or on this podcast, right? People experiencing me in these ways, it makes it so there really isn't a sell, right? So I won't go too much in depth here because last week's episode was really talking about soulful branding. If you haven't caught that yet, you may want to, because this has been, I mean, dramatic. If I can just give a few examples, I would say, you know, this is what made the difference from me being able to start up this brand new boutique that had this great vision back in the beginning of my entrepreneurial journey, and being able to have one of the major local magazines sponsor an event for me and do a whole page ad in their magazine advertising that event. It's what allowed me to, as I was being a food photographer for a season, it allowed me to get amazing deal offers and business opportunities of being able to be the photographer for cookbooks and for magazines and for newspapers and have some incredible opportunities that way. It was the branding. It wasn't me out hustling and working harder and selling more. It was being professional and being soulful and strategic in how my brand was being positioned so that when people experience it, they could say, oh, wow, this is somebody that we can trust, right? This is somebody we know, like, and trust. That's the biggest factors that would lead to a sale. And soulful strategic branding totally helps with that. And I honestly could not be where I am in my business without that. So definitely something that if you want to dive in more with me, I do have an upcoming Soul Brand Camp workshop that's going to be absolutely epic. And I have some other amazing offerings that are just powerfully supportive to really helping you dial in on what is your soul brand and how to bring that to life so that it can do more of the heavy lifting in your business and you can just show up to serve. right? So if you're curious about that, feel free to message me directly or private message me on social media, or feel free to visit my website and check out some of the details there. But massively, massively powerful. So strategy number five. Yeah, I'm like, which one should I do first? I'm going to do this one. Okay, so this one is clear boundaries, which, of course, this is not rocket science. So I know a lot of you are thinking that this is for sure true, but I wanted to talk about one of the nuances that makes it harder. Well, let's say two of the little nuances that make it harder for us to maintain clear boundaries between our work life and our home and family life. So the first is the nuance of valuing all of the roles in the home and family and our business. So one of the tricky places that I feel like, got me so tripped up on being able to keep these healthy boundaries is that honestly, my business was more of a high for me. So I could go in, make a difference, post something on Facebook, and people would just comment about how amazing it was and how much it meant to them, how it changed their life. And then I'd go into my family life and my kids would be crying and throwing a tantrum. My house would be torn apart. It was just not a high a lot of the time. And so that, and I'm sure a lot of you can relate that you, especially when you're doing more work that you really enjoy and that you love, it can be kind of a downer to head back into home and family life in contrast with that. And I see a lot of people get really addicted to that high. And that's where workaholism is born, is continuing to need that high. And in my case, I was getting a lot of my value and worth from my business. So that high was telling me that I mattered. Whereas when I went back into my home and family life, it wasn't always that way. In fact, it was, sometimes really rough that way. Parenting and raising a family and balancing all the crazy things we're balancing in life, it's messy, right? And so between bills and cleaning up and washing dishes and scrubbing burnt out stuff out of pans, like this is maybe not as exciting as really changing somebody's life with your business and your program. So this became a huge wake-up call to me, which I've referred to this time if you've been listening to the show in other episodes, but where I really crumbled under the workaholism, had massive adrenal fatigue, had to take off working for an entire year to really find my center again. And during that year, I actually really felt inspired that I needed to homeschool my kids and be with my family again and take this time to heal. And it was during that year that I came to see and experience that the everyday monotony in our lives is absolutely therapeutic. And that the more we lean in there, the more we bring presence to washing the dishes, brushing the hair, folding the laundry, sweeping the floor, the more that it fills us, and it fills us with actually sustainable fuel. Because the kind of fuel that we get just from our businesses and the highs there, it is a high and it can fuel us for a season, but it can also really burn us out because it's kind of like operating off of just really big spurts of energy. And when you're really grounded into your home life and you're present there and able to really soak that in, you'll find there's joy in absolutely all of it. And the kids stop acting out as much. And there's more harmony in your home and more love in your family. And it's amazing what lack of presence brings in our homes and how that creates just massive sabotage in being able to raise our families and to enjoy it, right? So presence would be the first step of being able to bring that home there, and also being able to really value the home and family roles primarily, right? Or to just even see them for the absolute gift that they are. Right? And this is where you start to have some real awe and appreciation that with each of your children, you only have about 18 short years with them. 18 short years, that flies by. I mean, I feel, and I'm sure some of you can relate, that my babies were babies yesterday. They're now heading into middle school and a year away from joining the high school, one of them. I mean, it's intense. And so, you know, really seeing, you have forever to work on your business. You really do. You have the rest of your life. And so focusing in and being present with your family and finding this harmonious balance is worth every effort, because you can't get these years back. We just can't. And I know from just feeling your hearts that some of you, I mean, you're doing your businesses because you need to also, right? I know for many years, my primary motivation in doing my businesses has been, yeah, sure, I want to make a difference in the world, for sure. But the bigger drivers have been financially, we need more income. We're not making it without bringing in extra income. And also, I don't want my husband or I to have to work, you know, all day long, every day long, and all night with multiple jobs just to try to keep groceries in the house and keep a roof over our heads, right? So our quality of life was a big concern, and being able to be together and have time with each other and not be exhausted and drained all the time were the primary motivations in my business. And as I've kept my focus really there, you know, as we're talking about that laser clarity, as I'm seeing that matters to me more than anything, right? It helps me to really prioritize and see, gosh, it would be cool to be on stage and it would be cool to be famous and do a big book tour, but does that really support my family in this phase of life? Does that really help meet our objectives, or am I just still trying to prove that I don't feel worthy and I don't feel valuable and loved, right? And that's why I want the big thing. So instead, having that clarity and valuing this role and this time with my family above everything else helps me to maintain clear boundaries. It helps me to turn off my phone and set it in the other room and not allow it to interrupt my conversations with my kids, because it helps me to value that they are the most important people to me on this planet. And if I fail them by not being present, by not as much as I possibly can, right? By not being there for them, then what did all the business work matter anyways? What did it matter, right? And it helps me to turn off my computer and shift gears and go back up and be with my family and get back in the dishes and in the bedtime grind and helping with homework and whatever else it might be, right? It's not as glamorous all the time, but man, is it healing, and does it make you whole? Right? It fills your life with peace and joy that the highs in business never can. And then as you do this and you keep yourself very grounded in that space with your home and family, then all the business highs that come, they're just icing on the cake, right? They're fun. It's a blast, right? But you're not dependent on them in order to survive and in order to live a good life. They just become the little cherry on top. And you can have tons of cherries on top. I'm not saying to limit that. I'm just saying when you put first things first, it changes how you're able to receive all those cherries and have more fun with them. And it also makes it so that you avoid the second nuance that I was going to bring up of how fear makes it really difficult for us to hold and maintain clear boundaries. So fear shows up as just that constant boiling anxiety in the background that is, you know, really distracting us from being present. And it's telling us that, hey, we're not going to make it this month, so you've got to work more and you've got to do more in your business and you've got to do blah, 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 10,000 more things. But recognizing fear as being a big saboteur of clear boundaries and I'd invite you to choose in this moment to no longer allow fear to drive your decision-making in your business and in your home life. It's a huge shift. And I'm pretty sure this is also a practice that we can never get perfect at, but that we should always be in the practice of, because it's life-changing in that, I'm just amazed at how often fear shows up as, you know, as I'm thinking, okay, it's 5 o'clock today. That's when I said I was going to end my work day. But oh my gosh, we need this extra thing to happen and we need this other thing to come in. And if it doesn't happen, or if this thing doesn't happen in 3 weeks, we're going to be in trouble and things are going to be really hard. And so I should maybe just work an extra hour today. And instead, me being able to listen to that and be like, oh, wait, who's talking? Oh, fear, I see you, I hear you again. And nope, we don't listen to fear. So instead, I check in with my heart. Heart, is it in alignment for me to work an extra hour today? And my heart says, nope, go be with your family. So then I hop up and I'm with my family, and I trust that by being in the right places at the right times and following that flow and following where my heart is saying to go, that it makes me open to the very solutions and possibilities that will resolve the things that I'm afraid about, right? So if I'm having a hard time struggling with a certain thing, in fact, I just did this yesterday. In fact, there's this big marketing campaign that we need to get launching. And honestly, I've been having a really hard time finding the right words for it. And it's been a real struggle this time. And so I just wasn't feeling well at the end of the workday and just was tempted to push it and try to force out the words and try to make it happen with the marketing, and just had such a strong feeling as I checked in and said, wait a minute, is this fear or is this in alignment? And the feeling was so strong of, no, this is totally fear and you should not keep going forward. And I went up, took a nap. I went outside. I spent some time under the stars after helping or my husband put the kids to bed because I was so, so worn out last night. But went outside, spent some time with the stars, dropped into my heart, and the answers started coming, right? Had I just forced and pushed and made it happen in my business work hours and worked that extra couple hours to try to make it happen and try to get that monkey of fear off my back, it would not have worked, right? It wouldn't have worked. So super, super crucial. The last of these strategies is kind of a newer one to me, but man, it's just lighting me up and it's been rapidly changing things in my business over the past 4 to 6 weeks. And that is something that my business coach teaches, which is that if you want to have a lifestyle that you love, then you need to automate and train yourself out of a job. So what she means by that is recognizing that as your business scales, you need to, any conversations or anything that you're teaching over and over and over again, that needs to become a training video that you send people to. Any of the key questions that you need to ask people before you're able to help them, that becomes a web form where people type in their responses to those questions and you're able to review it and be much more efficient with your time. This also refers to hiring and bringing in support as you are able to. And the big piece that I see happening with this whole conversation of automating and training yourself out of a job is the idea that a lot of us in our businesses are pretty stuck in how to take our businesses super seriously. So I see this all the time, and honestly, I'm so guilty of this too. I wish I wasn't, but it's so easy to be guilty of this, which is treating my business more like a hobby and kind of being on an emotional roller coaster with it instead of showing up with powerful consistency that's sustainable, that taking it seriously like a real business would, where there's actual goals and hardcore deadlines and, I mean, hardcore as in, you know, using wisdom with that, not making yourself crazy and burning yourself out to the max, but just really, the big piece that you see here is every business goes through certain phases. And so there are big creation phases in the initial parts of our business where we're just figuring it out, right? And we're having to come up with, how are we going to do marketing? How are we going to connect with people? How are we going to do fulfillment on sales? What does our business look and feel like? And there's this big creative process that a lot of people get stuck in, and they never shift out of that creative process into the sustainability of just running your business, which is more where you're in maintenance mode instead of creation mode. And what you bring in creation, once or twice a year in that, in that zone. And maybe when you're ready to really up-level your business to the next level, you have another creation phase. But ultimately, we're always seeing that our creation phases and the messy phases have an expiration date on them. They have an end time. And our intention is not to always be staying in that space, but to be bringing some powerful completion to that process so that we're then able to go into that maintenance mode where we're having more systems to support us and being able to thus be able to serve on bigger levels and make a bigger difference with the time that we're giving. And so this is really about recognizing that all the cool things that we can create for our businesses, you know, including all of our marketing graphics or, you know, all of the different pieces that we're doing. I mean, definitely branding could be in that category, or maybe you want to start a podcast or write a book or, you know, start a program, whatever it might be, that recognizing that there's an end point of that creation, right? Where you want to, not be staying in that zone all the time, because that's another way that we avoid and stay distracted from what actually will work in our business, what's actually going to affect our bottom line and bring more flow into our business and our homes and families financially and energetically. And so one of the analogies that I love and have maybe used in this show in previous episodes is that of the balance between keeping the lawn watered while also building the sprinkler set system, right? So in our creation phases, it has to be both, but then ultimately in our maintenance phases, we are mostly using the sprinkler system to keep the lawn watered, and we're showing up in our parts of brilliance, but we're not having to also manually water the lawn anymore. And so those creation phases should be making that scaling of your system so much easier. If you look at major companies, I mean, the airlines are my favorite one to look at for this, because it just kind of is mind blowing how you can hand in your luggage to the desk and it goes behind a little, you know, goes on the little rolling, what would you call that? You know what I'm saying, though. Goes back behind the curtain and somehow arrives in Morocco with you, or somehow arrives in Bali with you, or wherever it might be amidst all the other millions of luggage. And of course, there are a few instances where luggage gets missed, but by and large, most luggage makes it to its destination, right? And how did that happen? That happened because airlines scaled up their systems. They put in more of the sprinkler system so that they could then help and serve more people more effectively and efficiently. So I hope that these principles are supportive in your families and your business. I know this is a little bit longer of an episode, but I felt so strongly that this was the right topic to bring forward today and to really help and serve you in your lives and in bringing more joy, right? More joy in your family and in your life and in your business. It starts with really practicing these strategies and really seeing there is a way to balance both. I can tell you that I am a better mom as a result of being in my business. It is not exclusive. And I'm a better entrepreneur as a result of being a mother, right? So each lesson that I learn in either place, it benefits and blesses the other area of my life in tremendous ways. And honestly, my maintenance mode that I'm really working towards aggressively right now is to get things so that I'm only working 3 to 5 hours a day, Monday through Friday, with the ability to take off days as needed to be with my family more. And so that's what we're scaling up to and working towards. And it's not looking like it's going to be that far away. So, you know, it's seasons, right? It's a season in your business where it's going to be the 40-hour week and where you're working a ton. But if you follow these strategies and you're really smart about how you grow your business and set things up, then it will support you so that you do actually reach that goal. The business is not about if it will work for you. I've never met anybody that just can't do business. It's just, have you found the way to do business for you that works? Have you found the right business model that's a good fit for you and how you like to do things? Have you found the right product that really lights you up and inspires you and energizes you? And have you found the right practices in your home and family and personal life to support you in bringing a lot of joy into growing your business as well as joy in your family life? So goodness, sending you all so much love and cheering you on in this balance, in the practice of this balance. And really, I hope you walk away from this episode really feeling just how possible it is for you to balance both and to harmonize between your home and your work life and to really bring your both best to both places. It is possible. It requires work and strategy and clarity. It requires presence, and it requires trusting your own path and leaning in and believing that the divine holds your dreams sacred and is ready and willing to support you on your path in bringing those dreams to life. Cheering you on with so much love. We'll talk to you soon. Bye. And in the end, oh, yeah. Been listening to Joyful Living. If you haven't already done so, be sure to email me at quinn@joyfullivingmovement.com so I can send you our yummy Joyful Living welcome package filled with lots of awesomeness, including access to our private Joyful Living network. I read every email from my listeners and would love to hear from you. Also, be sure to leave a review on iTunes, and most importantly, have a joy-filled day.